It's what you want for me.
Good morning, First Baptist Church of Bayshore. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning to you all on this last Sunday in September. It is First Baptist Church of Bayshore, our 103rd, I believe, church anniversary. So happy anniversary to us. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, Heavenly Father, Blessed Son, Holy Spirit, thank you for yet another day. Father, we are thankful and grateful for our soul salvation in your Son, Christ Jesus, the only begotten. He is our Lord. He is our Savior. He is our Master. He is our atoning, perfect atoning sacrifice. He is our great high priest. He is our propitiation. He is the lid on our soul salvation. He is our mercy seat. We are grateful and thankful for all that he has done for us and through us. So, Father, as we prepare to rightly divide your word of truth, Father, I ask that you would speak to me. Speak through me. I pray that I am a willing vessel, I pray that the words that will be spoken and taught and shared and proclaimed are your words. Have your way. Bless everyone that is here in the sanctuary. Bless every home that is represented. And for those that are watching via live stream, bless them where they are. You know their needs, Father. Bring us all on one accord. If someone is missing, if a part of the body is missing, the body is incomplete. We need to be complete. We need to be whole so that we can therefore, as a body, go out and do the works that your Holy Spirit has empowered us to do and to fulfill all that you have commanded us to do. So let us know your word, study your word, and apply it to our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Before we stand and going to our normal procedure, let us just sing this together. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Amen. May we stand. Our weekly recitation comes from 2 Timothy 2:15, and it says, a workman that need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Amen. Do we have any birthdays in the sanctuary? Any birthdays on this past week or any birthdays on this upcoming week? Okay, amen. You may be seated. Any anniversaries? We know it is the church's 103rd anniversary, so can we just say happy anniversary? Happy anniversary to First Baptist Church of Bayshore. That is a long time. Blessing upon blessing. Now, I would imagine it has not been without its struggles, but we are still here, despite it all. And let's see if we can maybe see something like that in the text as we before we get started. So, we've done our recitation. We've prayed in. We've acknowledged birthdays. There wasn't any. We have proclaimed happy anniversary. Now I think we will get into reading the text. I believe on last week when Minister Dr. Cornigans had us all stand and read it together, I believe that worked because live stream, they cannot hear you. You do not have access to the microphone. And of course, I do not want to monopolize everything. So if you have your books or if not have your Bible, can we stand and read the text for the week, which is coming from Leviticus chapter 24. It's Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, or Leviticus. I know that's not how we pronounce it, but Leviticus, because Levi was the tribe that the priesthood comes out of. And this is a book all about the priesthood. I mean, there are other things as well. But so, may we stand. Leviticus 24, beginning at verse 10. The name of the lesson, a blasphemer stoned. A blasphemer stoned. Leviticus 24, verses 10 through 23. And I am reading from the textbook. Let us begin. And the son of an Israelitish or Israelitish, a woman from Israel, okay? Woman whose father was an Egyptian went out among the children of Israel, and this son of the Israelitish woman and a man of Israel strove together in the camp. And the Israelitish woman's son blasphemed the name of the Lord and cursed. And they brought him unto Moses, and his mother's name was Shelemith, the daughter of Dibri of the tribe of Dan. And they put him in ward, that the mind of the Lord might be showed them. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, bring forth him that hath cursed without the camp, And let all that heard him lay their hands upon his head, and let all the congregation stone him. And thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel, saying, Whosoever curseth his God shall bear his sin. And he that blasphemeth the name of the Lord, he shall surely be put to death, and all the congregation shall certainly stone him, as well as the stranger, as he that is born in the land, when he blasphemeth the name of the Lord, shall be put to death. And he that killeth any man shall surely be put to death. And he that killeth a beast shall make it good, beast for beast. And if a man causeth a blemish in his neighbor, as he hath done, so shall it be done to him. Breach for breach, eye for eye, tooth for tooth. As he hath caused a blemish in a man, so shall it be done to him again. And he that killeth a beast, he shall restore it. And he that killeth a man, he shall be put to death. Ye shall have one manner of law, as well for the stranger as for one of your own country, for I am the Lord your God. And Moses spake to the children of Israel, that they should bring forth him that had cursed out of the camp, and stone him with stones. And the children of Israel did as the Lord commanded Moses. Amen. You may be seated. Now, since we have a few more students than I'm usually accustomed to, I'm already hot and sweaty, so y'all have to forgive me. I sweat easy. If I think about doing something strenuous, I start to sweat. But I got my right guard on, so don't you worry. Amen. I don't want to be offensive to anybody. Now, before we unpack this lesson, we have a little bit of time. I want to kind of summarize this unit. This quarter, Faith on Trial. That's the name of this quarter for the entire book. And this particular unit for this month, for the month of September, Learning God's Holiness. So I just want us to review just for a minute to get us to remember what this whole month has been about, and then we can apply that to today's lesson to help us to understand today's lesson a little bit better. Why? So that then we can look at the similarities of what Israel experienced and what we experience in our lives day to day. So we can see where things are similar so that we can learn from them. A wise man learns from the mistakes. A wise man, wise woman, wise person learns from the mistakes of others. So if we can see their mistakes and see where things may be similar in our lives, let us learn from them. If you read it and then go make the same mistakes, shame on you. That's your fault. You should have used some wisdom and learned from them. If you see somebody else doing something and they get chastised for it, well, I can go ahead and do it too. Why? You think you can do it better? So, let us just review so we can look for similarities and parallelisms and see how we can apply it to our lives. That's when we will focus on the lesson as it applies to us. Amen? So, just a little bit of review. Faith on trial. That's this quarter. Learning God's holiness. That's for this month. So what is it to be holy? To be holy, to be pure, to be devoted, to be separated. An object or a place or a day or a being devoted or dedicated to a particular purpose. Something that we deem separated and set apart. Something that is other, that has a specific purpose. That is what it means to be holy, to be set aside, set apart. To be determined that it is different. So we hold it to be something other. It is separate from what is common, what is debased. To be common is not a bad thing, but you know, if you treat something special as though it is something common and ordinary. You don't have as much respect for it. God is like, no, you can have respect for me. I am holy. You know, not that I just am holy. Holiness comes from God. God is the generator of all that is. So holiness comes from God, just like love. God is love. Yeah, because love comes from God. Not that God has it, God is it. Amen? So to be holy, to be separated. Now, faith on trial. What is faith? As these people understood it, as Moses, when he was writing these first five books, how did he understand the word faith? How did he define what faith is? So that, you know, and the people, how did they understand what faith is? You know, we say today, now faith, Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11 hadn't happened yet for these people. So how did they understand what faith was then? So they defined faith, and I got this out, you know, I translated it, found some examples and citations in the Old Testament where they used the word faith and how they translated the word faith back then. Faith, emun, that's how you pronounce it in Hebrew, emun. Faith means to be established, trusty, trustworthiness, firmness, security, fidelity, stability, steady, truly, dependability. Now, okay, Brother Smith, those are a lot of words. What does it mean? Just a quick example. Visualize this. We've all seen some action movies. You know, I like Indiana Jones, particularly, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark, because that was biblical, kind of, you know. He was trying to find the Ark of the Covenant, or even the third one, you know, when they were trying to find the Holy Grail of Christ. So, visualize, you know, a bridge over troubled waters. You know, let's say there's this big canyon with fast rushing water, gators in there, rocks. It's dangerous. But you got this raggedy footbridge that you have to cross it. Now, that footbridge looks old and antiquated. Looks like the ropes and the vines ready to snap. The foot planks, some of them are missing. Other ones look brittle. Like if you look at it wrong, it might break and snap in half. That is unsteady. That is not dependable. They say what faith is, it is sturdy. It's something that you can trust in. Oh, man, I'm not crossing that bridge. You see how that looks? It just looks shaky, man. You get up on top of there and the wind, the breeze start blowing. You start hearing some snaps and crackling and the vines start, them threads start unraveling. Well, that's not steady. It's not secure. It is not firm. It has no stability. They said, well, faith is stable. Faith is something that is trustworthy, trust-inducing, trust-affirming. It can build some hope and trust in it. I mean, I can depend on that because it's steady. So, faith on trial, that steadiness on trial, what does it mean to, what is trial? The action or process of testing something. When something is on trial, it is being tested. So, faith on trial is the testing of the faith, testing of that sturdiness, testing of that stability. So this quarter, this unit, well, this whole quarter is faith on trial, the steadiness being tested. And this particular month, learning the holiness of God, learning, observing, witnessing, experiencing the separatedness of God. Who God is, how God is, his character, and then what we are to do, how we are to be separate with faith that is steady and secure. Amen? So, that's just a little overview for the title, Faith on Trial, Learning God's Holiness. Now, again, before we jump into the rest of the lesson, a little more review and setting the context. Brother Smith, why do you bother setting the context? I want us to know the facts. So when we know all of the facts, we can come to a well-educated deduction. We can deduce. We can assume, for lack of a better term, we can assume the outcomes. You don't want to make a decision without all of the facts. You know, if you've ever had jury duty, what are the facts? Present the facts so we can make a decision. Well, what are the facts? We know Moses delivered the people out of Egypt. Exodus 14. I'm just going to go through maybe about, just very quickly, I'm going to reference about maybe say 15 different scriptures to help us to know who these people are and what they have experienced up to this point when we get into Leviticus chapter 24. What purpose does it serve? It helps us to get into their mindset. What do they know about God up to this point? How do they understand God? What have they experienced of God up to this point? So, Moses delivers. Exodus 14, after the Exodus and the Red Sea, when Moses saw God part the Red Sea, these people experienced that. They saw it. They lived it because they walked through on dry ground. Exodus 16, after the manna and water from the rock. They were complaining, we don't have any water. We don't have nothing to eat. You bring us out of Egypt. We were slaves. At least we had something to eat. And now you bring us out here in the middle of nowhere. It's the desert. There's no water. Then there is some water, and that water's bitter. They're just complaining. This has been their experience with God so far. Right now, when we get into Leviticus 24, they come through the Red Sea. They have all these experiences of what God is, who God is, how God is, what God requires and wants from us or from them. They're still at Mount Sinai. They're not wandering in the wilderness, not yet. Right now, they're camped out, learning, okay? Learning from Moses through, you know, of God through Moses, who God is. As far as they knew, God was just another God like all them other gods back in Egypt. He was just one of just a new name, a new God, new and improved, but it's just the same old thing. Nah, they got to learn. So, they come through the Red Sea. They're at Mount Sinai for about 1 year. They're there camped out. In that 1 year time, they receive the Ten Commandments, Exodus chapter 20. The covenant is affirmed. We taught that last year, you know, the preparation of a nation. All that the Lord said we will do, we agree to it. This is all in that first year that they're camped out on Mount Sinai. They've come through the Red Sea. They saw all of the plagues and all of that back in early in Exodus. So these are people who have witnessed this firsthand. This is not hearsay. This is not gossip. They saw it. They experienced it personally. And yet, they received the Ten Commandments. The covenant is affirmed. Exodus 24, Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and the 70 elders beheld God. Moses, come on up. You and 70 of the folk, come on up. And you're going to worship and you're going to see God. And they beheld some glory of God. You can see that. Go read Exodus 24. Moses goes up. He enters the cloud for 40 days. All of this is happening within that 1 year that they're camped out. Exodus 24 and 18, Moses goes up, enters the cloud for 40 days. Exodus 32, the people tell Aaron, make us gods. We don't know what happened to this Moses. He'd been gone for 40 days. Ain't nobody seen him. Moses had left Aaron and her, I think, in charge. If y'all got some questions, go talk to Aaron and her. All of this is within 1 year. So Moses is up there for 40 days. Month, not even good month and a half. Make us some gods that can go before us, because we don't know what happened to Moses. He might be dead. He might not even come back. You know he was old when he got started. You know how folk can start talking and start putting some fear in and some doubt into you. They can speak some doubt into your existence. Make us gods. God says, Moses, man, you're going down there. Them folk down there, them folk that you brought are acting up. Moses goes down. Who is on the Lord's side? And the Levites They did not worship the golden calf, so they were still right. Moses, come on. And they killed all them folk. Y'all up here worshiping. You know that the one true God, Yahweh, is the one that brought you out, and you want to go and worship. Aaron, what did these folk do to you that made you do this? Who was on the Lord's side? Moses goes back. He kills all those people. Then he said, look, now I'm going back up to God, to the Lord Yahweh, and see if I can intercede on behalf of you stiff-necked, difficult, you know, I don't know. He might have called them all sorts of things outside their name. We don't know. I'm going back up here to see if I can smooth things over with the Lord, because he ready to kill all of us. Y'all going to get me killed for some mess that y'all did. Just as an aside, your disobedience don't just affect you. It can have impacts and affect other folk. So Moses goes back up for another 40 days. He gets the tablets because, you know, he got them the first time and he broke them when he came down when they were worshiping the golden calf. He goes back up. Moses, you bring some tablets. You get the tablets ready this time. I did it last time and you broke them. You get them ready this time. So Moses gets the tablets ready and he goes back up. Well, Lord, show me your glory. And he lets Moses behold and puts him in the cleft of the rock. And, you know, the Lord, and Moses drops on his face and worships. All of this is within that 1 year that they're camped out. They haven't started wandering yet. And they've been complaining, disagreeing, angry, wanting to go back, having doubt, fear, and lack of faith. Moses comes down, his face is shining, the folk got scared. Last time Moses came down from the mountain, his face wasn't scared, and he killed all us. And now he's coming down, and his face is shining. Aaron took off running. Aaron, where you going? Man, look, your face is shining. Last time, I don't know what's going on. What might go down this time? Even Aaron got scared and took off running when Moses' face was shining. All of this is happening within that 1 year that they're camped out on Mount Sinai. Moses' face shining. Then God tells him, okay, this is what you got to do to build the tabernacle, the tent. You need something where I will reside, where they can come and offer worship, and it needs to be portable, transportable, because when you get up and start moving, you got to pack up and go, and we got to pack up quick. So he gives them the directions and the dimensions to build the tabernacle. The Ark of the Covenant is made. They actually build the temple, the tabernacle, the tent. Then Leviticus chapter 8, Aaron and his sons are ordained. They had already seen the Lord. Moses, Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, y'all come up, and 70 of the elders, 70 of the leaders of all of the different tribes, the different clans that make up the tribes, you know, the head of the families that make up the tribes, y'all all come up and see and get a little peek and glimpse of the glory of God, and they had done that. And then they go and, you know, Aaron and his sons get ordained, and they go and offer strange fire. Now, you've seen what God can do, and you offer strange fire. All of this is in that first year they're still camped out. They haven't started wandering yet. The Day of Atonement that minister spoke of last week. Yom Kippur. The priest, the high priest, goes in and offers sacrifice to make things right. All the sin that we have done over the last year to get us back right with God. Blood all over the place to sacrifice. He has to offer sacrifice for himself that he can get right, so that he can therefore go in and offer sacrifice for everybody else. And now we get to our lesson today. A blasphemer stoned. What does that have to do with everything? Like I said, they're still there for a year, camped out. Blaspheme. What does it mean to blaspheme? Blaspheme translates, it's nochab, to puncture, to perforate. You know, when you have a sheet with the little half slots in it so you can tear it easily, it's perforated, like a serrated edge of a knife. It's perforated. It has piercings. It has holes. So to blaspheme means to puncture, to put holes in it. With more or less violence. It means to pierce. The speaking of a negative spiritual sentence on people. To blaspheme. The textbook says blasphemy, the defamation of God's character and glory by word or deed. So blasphemy is not just the saying of something hurtful that can pierce and puncture and put holes in something. It is also action. So here we see today's lesson, Leviticus 24. There's a young man who is half Jew, half Egyptian. Now, is that important? You know, lack of a better term, you know, I'm not even going to say it because, you know, that's just probably not right to say, but he was half-blooded. Now, does that have any significance on the lesson? It's mentioned for a reason. Maybe because his mother was a Jew, his father was an Egyptian. Maybe he was a double-minded man in all his ways. Maybe he worshipped his mother's God and worshipped his daddy's gods that were back in Egypt. We don't know. Doesn't say. We're just going to speculate. But they mentioned that he is half Jewish and half Egyptian. So with that, you bring your traditions and your customs with you. So maybe he worshipped both the Lord God Yahweh, the one true God, and maybe he still held on to some of his things that his ancestors did back in Egypt. We don't know, but all we know is that's who this person was. And he got into a fight with a Jewish man. And they're out there fist fighting or whatever. Maybe they was using some colorful language. We don't know. We don't know who was winning the fight, but they were fighting. And it says he blasphemed. He talked about in an injurious way. He was assaulting God's name, God's character, God's glory by his words and or by his deeds. He was puncturing holes in God's character. He was blaspheming and he cursed. Cursed to be light, to be easy, trifling. So this man was trifling God's name. Now, what exactly does that mean? That might not be grammatically correct, but we understand when something's, oh, they just trifling. They just half-stepping. Well, here he was in puncturing holes in God's name and God's character, making him common and not separate, not respecting him as holy, but making him common like one of his daddy's gods back in Egypt. Puncturing and piercing holes into his character, into his glory. Blaspheming and cursing. And the folks said, well, wait a minute now. You're about to get us in trouble. We know how God has treated us just in this past year alone. What we have witnessed, what we have experienced, what God has done. And this man is up here cussing God, talking about God all out of his name. And what does that mean for us? How are we piercing and punching holes and poking holes into God's character, into God's glory, into his name? People throw God's name out cussing all day long on TV, commercials, you know, whether it's print, TV, movies. But these people, let's back up for a minute. In Exodus 20, when he gives them the commandments, the Ten Commandments, you know, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt. You shall have no other gods before me, blah, blah, blah. You know, the first couple of commandments are the relationship between God and man, and the rest of them are between man and man. And he says, you know, you shall have no other gods, and you shall not blaspheme, and, you know, on and on and on. So here this man is cussing and blaspheming God. So the people said, well, look, what are we supposed to do? God didn't tell us exactly what to do and when to do it if something happens. So they wait. Look, go tell Moses what happened. And so we can sit and wait and figure out what God wants us to do. So at least they were smart in that They got the man, gave him to Moses. Moses put him in ward or jail or whatever you want to call it for that time being until they, and they waited on God. Now, of course, we want justice right away, right now, particularly if you have been on the wrong end of it, on the wrong end of injustice. I want some justice right now. Now, whether it's justice or vengeance, you be the judge. I just want to get even. Well, that ain't justice. What are you going to do? You need to wait on the Lord. What does God want us to do? So they wait. God says, look, verse 13, and the Lord spake unto Moses, bring him forth. The Lord is telling Moses. The Lord spake unto Moses, bring him forth that hath cursed without the camp. Let all that heard him lay their hands upon his head, and let all the congregation stone him. You heard it. You saw him bad-mouthing me. Yeah, you know, I did. But God, look, man, I don't want to get involved. Do you have a choice here? Let everybody that heard, let everybody that saw, that everybody that may have experienced this, that y'all got some responsibilities. So now, of course, we can apply that to our lives today. When you see injustice, not just on God, but if you see it something, if you see it wrong, are we supposed to just look the other way? Look, that ain't my business. I know there's some stuff going on in that house or with that family. I know that there's this coworker that's helping themselves to all the extra post-it notes and postage and sending their mail out through the cheating and robbing and stealing. Well, you know, the boss is greedy anyway, so good for him. Let him get robbed. Are we supposed to just accept that? Or are we supposed to get involved? Well, here, everybody that heard, y'all lay your hands on them. Now, that's similar to what Minister Cornigan's taught on last week with the scapegoat. They laid their hands on them so that all of the sin was kind of transferred to that animal and then let that animal carry that sin away. The sin was still there, but symbolically it was carried away. Well, we know, of course, Jesus doesn't just carry it away. He removes it altogether. But so for this lesson here, lay your hands on them. Signifying and symbolizing that, look, we're not guilty. You are guilty by yourself. You cussed God. You were in here fighting. Take him outside the camp. Now, why did they have to take him outside of the camp before they killed him? Anybody? Because if you kill him in the camp, you defile the camp. So now everything is dirty. Just like when they had ordained Aaron and his sons, and they had to sprinkle blood on them and put the anointing oil and all of that, and it mentions it again with the Day of Atonement. After the animal is sacrificed for the sins, they have to clean house, because all of the sin is so dirty and has such long-term lasting effects. We have to kind of consecrate and make everything holy and righteous all over again every year. So if we defile the camp by killing this man in the camp, everything is dirty. So now we got to try to get everything clean all over again. So take him outside the camp and kill him there so that the camp can stay holy. God is establishing his holiness, letting you know, I am separate. I am set apart from all this sin and evil and wrongdoing. And I need you to be that way. I have called you to be my people. You exist in this land, in this world, but you are to be separate from this world in your conduct, in your speech, in your thinking, in how you go about, in your relationship with me, in your relationship with them. You are to be holy with everybody. You are to be a nation of priests. You are supposed to be intercessors, showing people how to be holy, showing them what holiness looks like, showing them what being set apart is. So, this lesson, this blasphemer gets stoned. And God says, you know, they waited on God to see what God had to say. Take him out of the camp and kill him. And then going forward, it's kind of that was kind of a reaction to what had happened. And now God is going to go and be proactive and say, now going forward, if anybody does this thing again, this is what you're going to do. So now that you already know, get this in the minutes, record this in the minutes so everybody can know. You know, church secretary, get this written down. We don't want, make sure we're going to ratify this and get this in the bylaws. If anything, going forward, this is how you're going to behave and this is what you're going to do. If this happens, this is, take this course of action. Amen. Verse, let's see, 16. And he that blasphemeth the name of the Lord, he shall surely be put to death, and all the congregation shall certainly stone him, as well as the stranger. So, whether the person is a full-fledged 100% Jew who is all, daddy's a Jew, well, at this point, they're not all Jews yet. I mean, yes, they had, some were circumcised, some had not been circumcised. They're sitting there for this whole year working out this thing. They're figuring this relationship out, this agreement out. They're setting the groundwork, the ground rules, the foundational points. This is what this relationship is. This is what this relationship is based on. This covenant, this contract, this testament that we have agreed to, that we have ratified. They sprinkled the blood on us. All of that. This is what this relationship, the constitution of this relationship. So, if it is a stranger, same thing applies to him as well as to you. Whether you've been a member in the church for 40 years or for 40 minutes, same things apply. Amen? So, and he that killeth any man shall surely be put to death, and he that killeth a beast shall make it good. So, what that's saying is life is important. Life is precious. Life is sacred. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. They call that the lex talionis. Equal punishment for the crime committed. Of course, when somebody wrongs us today, we want to get even and then some. God is limiting the then some. No. If this is the crime, then this is the punishment. You cannot go and exact more than what is right, what is righteous. And we said, what is righteousness? But what is fair? What is just? So the justice has to fit the crime. It has to be just. It has to be fair. It has to be balanced. The consequences of disobedience needs to be fair. So let me stop for a minute. Any comments and any questions? Anything anybody wants to add or to elaborate on? Anything that no one misunderstands at this point? As we said, they've been there for a year. They have not started wandering, not yet. All of this within that 1 year, the golden calf, the commandments, manna, complaining, grumbling, let's go back. This water is bitter. They've seen the Red Sea parted. They're sitting there camped out about a year. So they're approaching an anniversary, just like us today. It's an anniversary. How have they known God up until this point? We've already talked about how much they have experienced. And yet, what do you think their relationship with God is? Anyone? Let's not get quiet. Let's think about our own relationships. We've been with God more than just 1 year. How have we pierced God's character, punctured holes into his name, into his glory? How have we blasphemed God? Not with our words, but with our deeds. Have we blasphemed? Well, Brother Smith, you talking out the side of your neck. Now, I ain't never blasphemed the Lord. Have you pierced God's glory and his character with your behavior? Well, I hear one amen over here. Tell the truth and shame the devil. Have we pierced God? Just for a quick visualization, we've all seen a block of Swiss cheese. It's got a bunch of holes in it, you know, and you pay for those holes. But it's got a bunch of holes in it. I believe it's in 1 Thessalonians, somewhere chapter 2, 3, something like that. Paul says, so deeply do we love you that not only did we share the gospel, but we shared our very selves. That's one of my favorite scriptures. And then a little later on, he says, you know, I want to hurry up and come to you to make up anything that is lacking in your faith. So if your faith is shaky like that raggedy footbridge we talked about earlier, or your faith is like that block of Swiss cheese with a whole bunch of holes in it, Paul says, I want to come and I want to fill up some of them holes to make your faith solid, to make your faith secure, trustworthy. Remember all those definitions we talked about, how they understood what the word faith was then? I want to come and solidify your block of Swiss cheese. I want to fill in those holes so that your faith no longer has holes in it. So don't let your doubt add more holes, puncturing, piercing, putting more holes into your faith. No. Paul says, I want to come and help you make up whatever's lacking in your faith. So as we live our days today, whether your faith has some holes in it, whether your behavior is putting, puncturing, and piercing more holes into your salvation, into your faith life, or if someone you know has a bunch of holes, how are you helping them fill in their holes? Or are you helping them add some more holes? Are you blaspheming God, which is having a direct impact and effect on their faith? So before we close, any comments, any questions, any misunderstandings? Anybody agree or disagree? Yes, sister. And stand and speak a little clearly. And if you can't hear, I will repeat what she says because she doesn't have the mic. Go ahead, Sister Perry. Amen. Amen. Perfecting our faith. Amen. Did everybody hear that? Our righteousness is as filthy rags. Bunch of holes, moth-eaten. That raggedy footbridge that looks like it's about to pop. No, we need to have faith that is steady and secure. Faith that will help somebody else. Maybe, well, you know what, let me cross over my bridge. Let your faith be my bridge over my troubled waters. Well, if you can believe, I can believe. Let us not add holes to our faith. Let us not add holes to someone else's faith. Let us not blaspheme in word or deed. Amen. So I guess I'm going to end a little early because I know it's anniversary Sunday. I got to make sure that Deacon Taylor has time to get his microphones and things set up. Are there any comments? Are there any questions? Well, on next week, Elder Edmonds will be teaching Complaints About Manna, Lesson 5, and it will be coming from Numbers. So we're finally out of Leviticus, and we will be in Numbers. Numbers chapter 11, verses 4 through 23, Complaints About Manna. And at that point, I believe they start to wander. They begin wandering. So next week, they start to wander, I believe. Right now, for this week, they're still sitting there for about a year, learning who God is and what God is and what God wants and how it affects them and how they're supposed to be and what this relationship is and the fine print and all of that. Faith on trial. How has your faith been tested? Any comments, any questions? Anybody want to share how your faith has been tested before we pray out. I mean, you know, it doesn't have to be tested like it was here in the scripture, but if you see injustice and you do nothing about it, is your faith being tested when you're supposed to be obedient and do something about it? I had said once, a month or so ago, you know, the late great prophet James Brown said, get on up, get into it, get involved. He was speaking to, I think that might have been in, it was in one of the minor prophets. He said, you saw when they got snatched up and taken into exile and you were sitting over there giggling and not getting involved and not helping? No. If you know the right thing to do, James, I think chapter 5, if you know the right thing to do and you do not do it, it is a sin to you. So if you know what is right, if you know what is holy, and you choose not to do it, James said, and not James, brother James, the apostle James said, it is a sin to you. If somebody's hungry, well, praise God, meet their need. Don't just sit there, well, praise God, and keep on moving. Well, Lord, I said something. I did something. Yeah, but you did something that wasn't effective, that was to none effect. I need you to get involved. I need you to participate. I need you to fill in their holes. Amen. So, Elder, can you come and pray us out? Thank you for this opportunity. Let me step out of your way, Elder.
Let us bow our heads. Lord God, our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this Sunday school session. We thank you for our brother James, who facilitated this lesson. We thank you for your word that was taught, that we may understand and apply it to our lives. Thank you for each saint, each heart that heard and received this word to your glory and for our good. We pray in Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Never would have made it. Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, never. Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better, much better when I